with you guys regarding what services we provide for the civilian side regarding active shooter incidents. Yeah. So I'm just gonna go really quickly over these slides. Just be mindful that this is a condensed version of the PowerPoint we usually provide for the civilian side or the state and city public employees. So first thing, right? Active attack incidents. The terminology active shooter incident, active shooter, is kinda being kinda weighed out because there's other incidents happening currently, right? There's vehicle attacks, knife attacks, and so forth. So the terminology is more going toward active attack events currently. Okay? So I'll quickly go over some active attack incident statistics with you guys, some stress response we see for the victims, and also things we encourage civilians to do if, unfortunately, if they were to be involved in some kind of incident like this. Okay? So the definition, right? Active attack event is basically an attempted mass murder event. And that's what civilians have to understand, that it is a true active attempted mass murder event. Okay? Because the intent of the attacker is to murder people. Okay? Then that's how they have to understand it. That's how seriously they have to understand it. Okay? So the attacker, there is no profile. If there was a profile, we can narrow it down to certain individuals from a demographic, sex, age, race, whatever it may be. It would be easy to narrow down, right? But there is no current profile regarding it. That's why it's hard to predict when it's gonna happen. Okay. So I'm just gonna show you guys a really quick statistics as far as from 2000 to 2018, all that active attack incidents that has occurred across the United States. The thing about the alert program that we push through to not only our officers but civilians, it's backed by the FBI statistics. Okay? The alert program was adopted by the FBI in 2012 and is currently the national standard. Okay? So as you can see, the numbers have increased through the 18 years during the statistics. And you guys will all see during the years of 2010 to 2014, the numbers have drastically increased. So I'll just let the PowerPoint play through. And you guys can note the yellow are gun attacks, red are knife attacks, and the blue dots are vehicle attacks. So 316 total from the 19 years. Okay. So locations of attacks, right? A little bit over 50% was in commercial locations. Approximately 24%, I believe, was in school areas, outdoors, and other locations, and so forth. Okay. Number of deaths, right? The number of deaths depends really on a lot of factors, but I will mention just a couple. Okay. How quickly does law enforcement arrive? Okay. We know statistically, the faster law enforcement officers arrive on scene, the quicker the incident ends. Why? Because the attention turns to the law enforcement officers as opposed to the victims. So we encourage our officers, if there's active killing going on, people are getting killed, people are getting injured, you need to push forward. Okay? Address the threat immediately as soon as possible. Okay? Target availability. That's why we talk about that run, hide, fight, avoid, deny, defend, right? Target availability. If the victims can do something to protect themselves, right? Whether it's run, hide, fight, or whatever it may be, do it. Yeah? You can save your own lives. Yeah. Disaster response, we talk about the mentality when an incident occurs. Yeah. A lot of people, they always think, right? It's never gonna happen to me, it's never gonna happen in Hawaii, and so forth, right? That's that mindset. So even if they hear shots fired, right? They might not think, what was that? Was that what I think it was? Not really, so forth, right? They swing back and forth. That's the denial phase, right? The deliberation is, holy cow, is that really shot being fired, okay? What do I do? That's when that stress level increases, right? They have to make that critical decision on exactly what they're gonna do. And the next thing is the decisive movement. Once they realize what's truly going on, they make a decision, they need to be very decisive in what they're gonna do to protect themselves, protect people around them, and so forth. Okay. We tell civilians, don't deny it. If you think it is what it is, Okay, if you think it's actually true shots being fired, if you think people are dying, okay, don't argue with it, right? Act quickly. Go to the deliberation phase, which is the avoid, deny, and defend. Okay, run, hide, fight. There's all types of acronyms that are being used out on the field, whatever it may be, but these are the general terms most of the public is aware of. Okay, so avoid, run, right? Leave as soon as possible. Okay, know your exits. Know your secondary exits. Okay, call 911. If you can avoid being there, avoid being there. Okay, hide, deny or hide. Lock the doors. Okay, turn off the lights. Silence your phones. Keep out of sight, hide under a desk, whatever you need to. Okay? Make yourself unaware to the suspect. Okay? You need to barricade the door. Okay? Don't just think locking the door is going to be enough. Okay? Actively barricading, actively protecting yourself. Whether it be putting tables, podiums, whatever it is, keep stacking it up. Why are you doing that? Think about how you can get out of there. Are there alternate exits? Why you're in that deny, hide phase? And the last thing is defend and fight. So the main thing I preach to people if you're getting into that fight mode already, you gotta start changing your mentality, right? Okay? Positioning, think about where you're gonna position yourself. If you know that suspect is coming into where you are, position yourself properly, okay? Don't be standing in the back of the room. Might have to immediately attack the suspect as soon as he enters the building or enters the room, okay? Position yourself, grab the gun. Okay, grab a hold of it and fight like there's no tomorrow, right? Use whatever's available to you to neutralize that threat and protecting yourself and protecting others. And I talked about the shifting of the emotions, right? That fear has to come to anger, yeah? You have to shift in that mindset so that you can neutralize the suspect if you have that opportunity, if it ever gets that far. So we always go through this model with civilians, right? Attack starts, if you can get out of it, avoid, right? Get out of the scene. If you can't, deny them. Hide, lock the doors, barricade the doors, whatever it may be. Even if you're in that deny phase, if there's secondary exits, get to it. Okay, so you can come back to this avoid. And if you can't, there's no other exits, and you know that the suspect is coming into your room, defend yourself best you can. Okay, when the police arrive, please follow police orders, okay? There's a lot of things their officers are gonna have to be dealing with. They don't know who's involved, who's not involved, right? Follow their commands. Show your hands, okay? If they ask you to raise your hands, keep your hands up, okay? Don't move if they tell you don't move. When we train our police officers, these are the three things we kind of cover when we talk about active attack incidents. Stop the killing. So when officers come on scene, if there's active killing going on, their priority is stopping the killing, right? They're not worried about anything else. The shots are being fired. They have to stop the killing. So I know there's going to be people needing help immediately, whatever it may be, but they have to stop more killing before they can do anything else. Okay? Then the next thing they're going to go into is stopping the dying, which is to provide some sort of medicine, some kind of triage, whatever it may be. Okay? So just so we can get that immediate medicine as soon as possible, until we can get them to that higher level of care, which is the evacuation process. Our goal is to get the victims to that hospital end, which is the higher level of care I just mentioned, as soon as possible. So the last 4 years, we've been cross-training with the EMS and fire personnel, okay, and also with the other law enforcement agencies across the island, so that we're integrated training, so that if something like this should happen, we would have an integrated response, and it would be a coordinated response. Any questions?
Yeah, I mean, is this being presented in the classrooms? Is there active training scenarios for the students?
Currently, it's more for the school staff. We're not gonna push, obviously, because like I said, this is a condensed video. There are some videos that might be too graphic for children and so forth. So it's more toward the school staff. So at least they are aware of what they need to be doing.
But is there an intention to bring it to the students? I know other districts and other states actively have the students role play.
It would have to be something that's worked out with the DOE.
And have they reached out to you about that?
I believe the DOE has outside contractors also too, but we also work with them to make sure their plans that are in place are in sync.
You know, the most recent cases, you know, Buffalo and Texas.
Yes.
Social media, there were some warning signs in social media.
Right.
You know, with both that replacement manifesto and the you know, some of the other postings. How are you enabling parents, students, and staff to, you know, you guys can't police all that, the social media, but report these kinds of
things. So we always say, right? You see something, say something, right? So same thing, right? Some people, they broadcast what they might do, what their intentions are, or what they're even thinking about, right? So we always say, you see something, you say something. Whether it, if it's a school, whether it be to the school staff, to your school counselor, police officers, whatever it may be, see something, say something. And that's literally the main way we can get information regarding preventing possible incidents.
Yeah, the schools have done a good job of messaging, you know, they'll send the messages to parents, but how do you get the encouraging people who initially see these reports or see these things on social media to come forward more?
I think that is something the, let's say for students, I think it's something the school counselors have to work with. I believe it's something the school staff, and I think it's something that the teachers have to preach every single day, right? I think kids are more aware of what's going on social media, and I think they are more aware of what needs to be said and what they don't tell people.
As you mentioned, like, we get this, this is really for adults.
Yes.
How would you recommend a parent maybe talk to their kids about if they're in this type of situation, what to do? Because I mean, I think about like barricading a door, things like that, depending on how old the kid is.
Right.
They might not be able to help themselves.
So we do provide this class for our private entities also, so businesses, it can be small companies, whatever it may be. If they reach out to HPD, we can provide this course for you, for them. And if that's one way we can reach out to the parents to get their message, and then they can push it on to the kids, that might be one way.
I know Kauai police said they were gonna increase patrolling at the schools given the incident in Texas. Did that happen here as well?
Increase, I'm sorry?
Just patrolling around the schools.
You know what, I don't have the numbers to back any kind of statement. Reading regrets.
And also, we just got a notice from DOE that police were at Kapolei Middle School, some sort of threat. Can you talk about that?
The only thing I'm aware of is a juvenile was arrested for terroristic threatening in the first degree, and I can't really mention anything else because of the juvenile status. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.